السلام إنما خرجت لطلب الإصلاح في أمة جدي أريد أن أأمر بالمعروف وأنهي عن المنكر وأسير بسيرة جدي وأبي علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه. The days of the Azaw Sayyid Shuhada are continuing, and we are into the end of the last day of the month of Muharram. And we normally dedicate this day to remembering the tragedy of the arrival of the family of Imam Hussain to the city of Damascus. I'd mention in the Friday khutbah that I will, inshallah, not guaranteed, but I'll try to talk about this issue of discussing current issues, especially in the context of Palestine, in the azah and the majalis of the imam. And this is what, inshallah, I'll be talking about tonight. And the question is that, is it appropriate in the majalis of Imam Hussain alayhi salam to talk about any current issue? Now we have this issue of Palestine. Unfortunately, this issue has polarized the Shia social media circles and the people in the East as well as the West. You see the English, social media is Urdu, Farsi. You will see there is a polarization on both groups here. And speakers have basically expressed their opinions, and sometimes they have gone to the points of extreme, ifrat and tafreet, and not the middle path. And I would like to talk about it briefly. You know, and as I said, you know, I'm sure none of the two groups are going to be happy, but what can we do? What is the reality is the reality. But before I start into that, let me, you know, as a preface to my talk, explain these words of the Imam that I mentioned after the khutbah. And this is from the written will of the Imam that he gave to his brother Muhammad Hanafiya before he left Medina. And there he clarifies what is the mission, what is the purpose behind his mission. And the words he had chosen are very powerful. I'm just going to the main part of it, where he says, إِنَّمَا خَرَجْتُ لِطَلَبِ الْإِسْلَاحِ فِي أُمَّةِ جَدِّي. The word إِنَّمَا in Arabic is used to explain that this is the only reason. This is حَصْر. Exclusively, this is what I plan. So he says, إِنَّمَا خَرَجْتُ لِطَلَبِ الْإِسْلَاحِ فِي أُمَّةِ جَدِّي. I have risen for only one purpose, and that is to reform the community of my grandfather. Now, when we talk about this issue of reforming, this is an ongoing issue. This was basically the mission of Imam Hussain alayhi salam also. And then he explains, what is the religious basis or the method that I'm using here to justify my action? And he says, أريد أن أأمر بالمعروف وأنهي عن المنكر. In creating about this reformation, what I would like to do is, you know, call people towards the good and discourage them or prevent them from evil. And then further he says, don't think that what I'm doing is something new. This is not a bid'ah. وأسير أن أسير بسيرة جدي وعبي علي بن أبي طالب. And by doing this, I'm actually following the path of my grandfather and my father Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat. Even in this last line of the wasiyat of the Imam, you know, the Shi'i line is very clear. It's Rasulullah and then Ali bila fasl. There's nobody in between there. And this is where we see, this is the Shia perspective. But the important point that I would like to make is that when we talk about this mission of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, explained by himself in his own words, then you talk about the azah of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Can the azah of Sayyid al-Shuhada be different from the purpose that he had for his mission? No. Azadari becomes a vehicle for us annually to basically, you know, remember the tragedy, but also to exercise islah in order to make ourselves better Muslims, better Shias, you know, to make sure our aqidah is proper, our ahkam are right, you know, our character has been, you know, reformed, and all things about deen, whether it's aqidah, it is ahkam, it is akhlaq, it is history, it is the seerah of the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, everything comes in. You know, sometimes we hear these words that, well, you know, you only talk about Karbala. Well, Karbala is the ultimate goal of the majlis, and that is where we do at the end, musibat. You know, but that becomes a means for us to improve ourselves, to continue that mission of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. You know, for example, you would say, oh, what did you do in the first Āshurā in Australia? Well, I talked about the family life in Islam. But what is the family life to do with, you know, Karbala? Well, I talked about what are the principles, what are the issues, what are the challenges. And in all that, Quran comes in, hadith of the Ma'sumin come in, examples from the lives of the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt come in. So maybe, you know, it was not current, current issues, it was social issues of the community, but it is tied in with the purpose and the mission of Hussain ibn Ali alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat from the Akbar. So now let me talk about these two extremes on this issue of the current, you know, topics in majalis. There are two things I would like to mention here in the first part, for the first, group, and then I'll go to the other part and talk about two or three issues on that side. You know, first extreme is that, oh, don't talk about current issues in majalis at all. This is where I think it's important to look at, you know, what does Islam say? It's not what I think or what I feel. You know, the first point I would like to raise is the issue of importance of being concerned for the oppressed people, in general, for Muslim. And, you know, although now we are talking about the issue of Palestine, but it's a general concept for us. This issue of being concerned for the oppressed people, this idea has been there in the family of Banu Hashim even before Islam. So I would like to take you there first before we go to Karbala. This is the time when the Prophet is already born. He is 20 years old. Islam has not yet started. It will start 20 years after that. And at that time, a Yemeni trader came from Yemen to Mecca. And he, you know, sold his goods to As bin Al-Wa'il. As bin Wa'il, the father of Amr ibn As, who became more famous later on. And so he was a prominent member of the, you know, Quraysh in Mecca. So he basically said, okay, I'll buy your goods. But the payment was not done immediately. He said, you know, you come to me later on. But when this Yemeni trader would go to him again and again, he would say, oh, come tomorrow. He started unnecessarily delaying the payment, you know, although he had the ability to do that. You know, he was trying to probably do something so that this person will become frustrated and go back to Yemen. And he will just keep the goods, you know. So the niyat was already suspect there. And so then he goes into this top of the hill known as Abu Qubais by the Kaaba. And he very, you know, in a loud voice started complaining that I am Muslim, you know, you're a prominent member of your city, has taken my goods and doesn't want to pay. The person, the first person to respond to his cry for help was actually Zubair bin Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of Rasulullah. And this is where we see that he actually decided that I'm going to support him because he is being oppressed in this, you know, business transaction. And he, this is where he said, I want people to come with me. And they made a pact among themselves. And it's very well known in history as Hilful Fudul. Hilful Fudul, this is where they got together and made a pact that whether it is an outsider coming to Mecca or a local person in Mecca, if he is treated unjustly and he wants our help, we will stand up for his right against the zalim. One of those individuals who was part of that pact was this 20-year-old young man by the name of Muhammad bin Abdullah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so this concept of, you know, standing up and helping the Muslim has been there even before Islam in Banu Hashim. Hilful Fudul is actually initiated by Banu Hashim. And interestingly, Imam Hussain alayhi salam during his days, and this is probably a year or two before Karbala, that Imam had a property in Medina. And there was a dispute with him and somebody else. And so Imam goes to Walid bin Uqba, who was the governor till the time Imam left Medina. He goes to him, you are the governor, you have to deal with this issue. This is my property, it's my right. And Walid bin Uqba didn't really care about it, didn't do anything. And this is where Imam then goes to him and he warns him, if you don't take the right step to restore my right here, I will take out my sword and I will call people for something similar to Hilful Fudul to get my right from the person who is zalim. And so we see this concept of helping the Muslim, which is there, especially in the family of Banu Hashim. Salawat Pranay Kbarar. In another hadith from the Prophet, where he talks about the social responsibilities and duties that we have towards one another, one line from it, وَمَنْ أَخَذَ لِلْمَظْلُومِ مِنَ الظَّالِمِ كَانَ مَعِي فِي الْجَنَّةِ مُصَاحِبًا. You know, whoever takes for the oppressed his right from the oppressor will be with me in the Jannah as a companion. This is just one line from a longer hadith on all these social issues. This is the Prophet. We come to Amir al-Mu'mineen. In his famous khutbah, khutbah number 3 in Nahj al-Balagha, known as khutbah Sheikh Shiqiyya, where he talks about the system of khilafat, how he criticizes the first and the second and the third khalifa there. In the beginning, he says that, and this is the time when the people of Medina have come to him, insisting on him to become their leader. And the number of the people was huge. The gathering was very huge. To the extent that, you know, Hassan and Hussein were crushed. You know, people were just pushing. And they were insisting that, no, we will not, you know, take a no for the answer that we want from you. And at that time, Ali was very reluctant. Because they came to him 24 years. 24 or 25 years exactly on the day of Ghadir. So they came on the day of Ghadir to him, but they came very late. And during that time, there was a lot of changes, corruption in the whole system. Ali was hesitant because he knew that if I come in, I will have to change things. And people wouldn't like, especially those who are already used to the privileges given to them by the Khalifa, especially the second and the third Khalifa. And so, but the pressure of the people was such, he gave in a way, accepted that responsibility. The way he describes it, see, there are two, he gives two reasons for it. فَعَمَّ وَالَّذِي فَلَقَ الْحَبَّ وَبَرَعَ النَّسَمَ. He says, I swear by the one who split the seed and who created the soul. لَوْلَا حُضُورُ الْحَاضِرُ وَقِيَامُ الْحُجَّ بِوُجُودِ النَّاصِرِ. He says, first proof, or reason why I am accepting this Khilafat is because if it had not been for this gathering, which shows the presence of supporters, means in the first case in Saqifah, after Saqifah, nobody was there to help me. But here now, I don't have that excuse to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the people did not come to support. And so this support of the people and the masses is there, number one. That's first reason. The second, he says, and what Allah has taken as a pledge from ulama, وَمَا أَخَذَ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْعُلَمَاءَ أَنْ لَا يُقِرُّ عَلَى كِذَّةِ ظَالِمٍ وَلَا سَغْبِ مَظْلُومٍ. And if it had not been for the, that Allah has taken as a pledge from the ulama, that they should not be indifferent when they see that the oppressor is filled in his belly with the food and the oppressed is staying hungry in the society. He says, if it hadn't been for the number of supporters and this pledge that Allah has taken from the ulama not to be indifferent when they see the situation of zalim and mazloom, he says, I would have just put the reign of Khilafat back on the neck of that rider. I wouldn't have cared about it. So even Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, he accepted this rule and the Khilafat because of the pledge that Allah has taken from the ulama, and of course our imams are at the top of that. That if you see zalim and mazloom, if you are able to do something, you have to do. You cannot be indifferent to the situation. And of course there are levels of amr bil ma'ruf and nahy al munkar, starting with the mental and spiritual, you know, opposition to the zalim, and then verbal, and then if you have the ability to do something, by actions. Salawat Mulana Akbar. Even in the last will of Ali, when he talks to his family members and also the content of that will is addressed to us also. It seems that he had asked his scribe to be there, because he says, and to whomever this writing of me reaches. So he's talking to everyone. And in that, initially he addresses Hassan and Hussein. But even what he says to his sons is not only for them, the concept and the teachings are general. And one of those sentences is, وَكُونَ لِلظَّالِمِ خَصْمًا وَلِلْمَظْلُومِ عَوْنًا. His endures tense, addressing the sons, he says that you be khasman, you know, opponent of the oppressor, and be the supporter of the mazloom and the oppressed one. So this is as far as the tradition and the seerah of Ali is concerned. Look at Imam Hussain alayhi salam himself. When his caravan was confronted with the cavalry force of Hur, you know the whole story. You must have heard it, you know, recently also in the majalis in Muharram, that they were thirsty and Imam actually provided water for them. That was Imam's way of dealing with those who are coming as enemies. But you know, maybe he can soften their heart and then they might listen to his message. And that's what happened, actually. You know, the cavalry moved away a little bit. They settled down on the other side. Imam was with his people on the other side. And time of Zuhr came. And Imam asked Hur, are you going to lead namaz for your own soldiers separately, or are you going to join me? And he said, no, I'll come with my cavalry, you know, soldiers to do the salat behind you. So that was the, you know, beginning of the kind of openness in the heart of Hur. Imam seized that moment. After the Zuhr prayer, he stood up and gave a very short khutbah, sermon, where he recites to them a hadith from his grandfather. He says, Ya ayyuhan nas, inna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, look at the hadith that he chooses from his grandfather. For that moment, he says, my grandfather said, man ra'a sultanan ja'iran, mustahillan liharamillah, lihurumillah, ناكساً لعهد الله مخالفاً لسنة رسول الله يعمل في عباد الله بالإثم والعدوان. He says, if a person witnesses or sees a tyrant ruler, unjust ruler, you know, making haram of Allah to be halal, and he violates the covenant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he goes against the sunnah of Rasulullah, he acts among the people sinfully and aggressively against them, فَلَمْ يُغَيِّرْ عَلَيْهِ بِفِعْلٍ وَلَا قَوْلٍ, and that person who witnesses such a ruler does not do anything to change the situation by action or words, depending on different, everybody has a different capability and situation there. He says, if that person doesn't do anything, even at least not through words, لَكَانَ حَقًّا عَلَى اللَّهِ أَن يُدْخَلَ مَدْخَلَ, then Allah would have a right to put that indifferent person alongside the zalim ruler on the day of Qiyamah together. This is Hussain ibn Ali's message to Hur and for everyone else in the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Sajjad, in Saif Sajjadiyya, dua number 8, there he begins with the words, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika, Wallah, I seek your protection from certain things. One of the items in there, an na'budu zaliman aw nakhdhulu malhufan. Wallah, I seek your protection, you know, from helping an unjust person or abandoning a person who is in distress. And so what I would like to say here is that you look at the hilful fudul of before Islam, initiated by Banu Hashim, look at the seerah of Rasulullah, you look at the example of Ali, look at the words of Hussein. When you look at all of these things together, we see this support for the oppressed and opposing the zalim. This is actually what Islam and the Islam of Shiaism wants from you. There is no two way, you know, opinions on this issue. So talking about the tragedy of those who have been oppressed, you know, especially when you look at the current situation of the Palestinians in the Gaza Strip, to talk about them is not wrong, as a general statement I'm making here. However, it doesn't mean that the whole majlis from the beginning of to the end be about it. Maybe you can talk it, even every majlis you can talk about it, but it can't be that, you know, it's entirely, you know, only on that one specific issue. But talking about, you know, those who are oppressed, those who are suffering, creating this awareness. You know, we are Muslims, we are Shias. Look at these millions of non-Muslims around the world, especially in the West. They are also speaking out against Israel in support of these innocent civilians who are being killed. Because this is even touching people on that level of humanity, irrespective of their race or religion. And we cannot be indifferent to this issue at all. Salawat pranayak barakat. But then, you know, the objection which comes up, okay, you have said this, but Palestinians are Nasibi. You know, we have different categories of people, Muslim, Kafir, Mu'min, Shia, Sunni, you know, Nasibi. Nasibi means those people who have hatred towards the Ahlul Bayt. And one of the arguments is used that, you know, why you would want to talk even or support or have this sympathy for the Palestinian, they are Nasibi. Just ask this question. Ask to yourself. Don't just, you know, go by who is saying that in social media or on a member, whether it's me or anyone else. Go and say, are all the Palestinian really Nasibi? Are you sure about it? Yes, they are Sunni. But does it mean that every Sunni is Nasibi? Why do our mujtahideen separate Sunni from Nasibi in the ahkam of Taharat and Najasat? Sunni is okay, his zabiha is halal, marriage is also okay. I'm using the word okay only, huh? Nothing else here. Don't get ideas. But when it comes to Nasibi, we consider them to be kafir. They are considered to be najis. So why are Sunnis and Nasibi separated in our fiqh? Because not every Sunni by definition is a Nasibi. And this is where we have to understand, you know, majority. Our sympathy and support is for whom? Not for a political entity. If you go through my khutbas from October of last year till now, I've constantly talked about this issue. But you will never see that I have ever referred to any political entity. I'm talking about the Palestinian people. We are talking about innocent children and civilian men and women whom Israel is killing. The number has reached to 40,000, according to one report I was just reading 2-3 days ago. According to their own estimate, they're saying, oh, we have killed about 15,000 of these terrorists. It means from that 40,000, 25,000 were not, even according to their calculation, terrorists. You're talking about 25,000 men, women, and children innocently killed. And you say, oh, well, we don't have to care about it. Maybe they are Sunni, but that doesn't mean they are basically, Nasibi. If you really want to become very technical from the theological point of view, I can guide you to give you a better term, not Sahibi and Nasibi. You can use the term Mustada'af for them. Mustada'af is a Muslim who doesn't know much about the Ahlul Bayt because the message has not reached to him. And a Mustada'af is not Nasibi. He doesn't know. You know, sometimes they actually respect them. There is this sense of even love for the Ahlul Bayt to some extent among Sunnis. But they don't accept them as imams because they don't know much about it. So they are mustad'af. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, not every Sunni is an Asibi. Salawat pranayak barar. Let me give you an example from Karbala itself. After the events of Karbala, You know, the people of Medina, their eyes opened up. They turned against Yazid. They sent a fact-finding mission, you know, a delegation to Damascus. They came back with a report. And majority of them, actually all of them actually, come and said that, oh, you know, you sent us to see what kind of a Khalifa he is there. We are not even sure whether he's a Muslim or not. And one of them said that, actually, I agree with my colleagues here, even though I took the bribe that they gave to me. So he was being more clever, actually, than the others. You know, so, and because of that report, the people of Medina decided to rebel against Yazid. Things became so bad for the Banu Umayyah, who were representing Yazid in Medina, that they started feeling threatened with their lives. And who was the head of Banu Umayyah in Medina? Marwan bin Hakam. And if you know history, I would not just classify him as a Sunni, I would say he is a real example of Nasibi. He has hatred towards the Ahlul Bayt. He was part of all this zulm which has happened to Imam Hassan, to Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And yet, when things change against Banu Umayyah in Medina, Marwan is looking for refuge for his wife and children, not for himself. He takes his wife and children to the house of Abdullah bin Umar. And Abdullah bin Umar says no. You know, where does he end up at the end? He goes to the door of Imam Sajjad. What did the Imam do? This Nasibi has come at the door, asking for refuge, not for himself, but for his wife and children. And Imam opened the door, gave them protection. Are we more azadar than Imam Sajjad? Just think about it. So before we use these, you know, words in that loose, you know, sense, let's be careful about it. It's very much similar like the case of Amir al-Mu'mineen and Osman. Did Ali like Osman? Did Ali agree with the policies of Osman? Absolutely not. In Khutbah Sheikh Shakhiya, where he criticizes the first Khilafat and the second and the third one, he has reserved his most harsh words for Osman because of his, you know, unjust policies. Yet what happens when the Muslims at that time got fed up with the zulm and injustice of Osman and his administration? These Muslims and the Sahaba, they put the house of Osman under siege to the extent that they stopped the supply of water and food to his house. What does Ali do at that time? Ali doesn't like Osman. But he called Hassan and Hussein. He says, come with your swords. Bring the youths of Banu Hashim with you. Ask them all to come with their swords. And take water bags and sacks of grains. And even if you have to break the siege by fighting, do that. Go to the door of Osman and convey the water and food there. This is where we have to realize that, you know, Ahlul Bayt and the standard that they are presenting to us is of a much, much higher level. When Imam Sajjad, you know, gave refuge to the family of Marwan, it was not only just a help, it was actually a slap on the face of Marwan. Let's see the difference between you and us. We will never stoop down to your level, even though you have been so much unjust to us and to my family. Salawat padhne ek par. So this is the first part. Now we come to the second part. And I'm not looking at the clock. I have to complete my subject fully. Salawat padhne ek par. On the other hand, when I look at all these things in the social media, speakers and social activists from the Shias, English-speaking, Urdu-speaking, Farsi-speaking, it seems sometimes they present this issue of Palestine as the essential part of Azad. In a sense that even say, if you don't do that, your azadari is not azadari. Your azadari is not the real azadari. And this is the other extreme of this whole, you know, debate and discussion going on. And these statements are just emotions and hyperboles and nothing else. You have to understand azadari of Imam Hussain is something at a much, much higher level. There are some very well-meaning speakers and ulama. They also get carried away. There is one Urdu-speaking scholar. In his speech, he basically says that your haqiqi azadari, use the word haqiqi azadari. You know haqiqi means what? Means real and true azadari is only when you carry the alam of Hazrat Abbas with the flag of Palestine. If this is not ghulu, an exaggeration, what is ghulu? This is not acceptable. When you said that is haqiqi azadari, so everyone else who doesn't do that, their azadari is not haqiqi. It is not real. And I have a problem with the whole attitude of classifying azadar between haqiqi and ghayri haqiqi. Baba, you had political parties in Pakistan, you know, haqiqi and something else. Don't use those labels for azadar. And this is where, you know, the problem is, because as soon as you start using these words that we are true azadar, others are not, you cannot insult and disrespect any azadar who comes to the farsh of azad of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Even if he or she does not do the azadari according to your standard or the way you think it should be. There can be levels of azadari, the way we have levels in ibadat. Amir al-Mu'minin's famous hadith where he says, you know, there are some people who do ibadat for what? For jannat. There are some who do the ibadat and namaz because they are afraid of Jahannam. But there are some who do ibadat because they really consider Allah to be worthy of being worshipped. Does it mean that somebody who does the namaz because he wants Jannah, his namaz is batil? He will not get the reward? Does it mean that somebody who is doing the namaz out of the fear of Jahannam, his namaz is batil? No, there are different levels. Their levels of reward would be different. So even in azadari, people can do azadari at different levels in their own ways. You cannot bring your criteria and say, this is the haqiqi azadari, and whatever else is there is wrong. Even though you don't use those words wrong, but when you say haqiqi is this, it means all others or other formats are ghayri haqiqi. And so this is one issue that we have to be very careful about. Salawat. Some speakers, to highlight the suffering of the Palestinians, they say, okay, so the oppressor is Netanyahu and the company and those who are supporting them. And then they use the word Yazidi Zaman for them. So far, it's okay. You want to call them Yazid, you want to call them Yazidi, and we say that. But then sometimes some of them get real overexcited. So they already looked at the Israeli leaders and their American supporters. They say, oh, this is Yazidi Zaman. Then they will look at the other side. Then they look for somebody to be classified as Hussain Zaman. And I think this is where the problem lies. You can have Yazidi Zaman, curse them if you want, but don't bring the status of Hussein ibn Ali down. You cannot compare anyone from our leaders, the Shia leaders, you know, to Hussein ibn Ali. There is no one who is Hussein Zaman. Hussein was only one Hussein. In the second khutbah on Nahjul Balagha, Amir al-Mu'mineen at the end has a statement where he says, لا يقاس بآل محمد من هذه الأمة أحد. No one from the Ummah can be compared equal to آل محمد. Why? لا يسوى بهم من جرت نعمتهم وعليه عبدا. He said, this can never be that those who are under the obligation of Ahlul Bayt can be on the level of the Ahlul Bayt. Greatest of the ulama, but they are servants of Hussein. Do not ever use this term of, you know, Hussein is a man for them. Not only that, you talk about Imam Hussain alayhi salam. I would say do not even compare anyone from our leaders to the Ashab of Hussein because they have a special status. And let me read to you a statement from Ayatollah Khamenei himself. Because this is how they use this term sometimes. There is a clip from him where he says, and I'll read the Farsi words and give you the translation. He says, Tanam mi larze. My body shivers. An vakhti ke kasani isme mubarak amir al-mu'minin mi avaran. Wa isme vali asr ra mi avaran. Wa baad isme mara ham dunbalash mi avaran. He says, my body shivers when some people say the blessed name of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the name of Wali Asr and then mention our name after that. He says, Tanam mi larze, my body shivers. An haqa'iq noor mutlaq. Ba maha ke gharq dar zulmatim. They, Ali and the Imam of the time, they are reality of the pure light, where we are at the depth of darkness. Don't bring my name with their name. He himself is saying this. Ma koja wa kam tarin wa kuchik tarin shagirdan an koja. How can we be compared to their most humble and ordinary students? Ma koja wa kambare anaha koja. How can we be compared to their qambar, who was a servant and slave of Ali? He further says, Ma koja wa ghulam habashi fida shude dar Karbala Imam Hussain koja. How can we be compared to the Abyssinian slave who sacrificed in the Karbala of Imam Hussain alayhi salam? ما خاک پای آن غلام محسوب نمی شویم. We are not even comparable to the dust beneath the feet of that slave. And so do not try to use this term of Hussein is Aman, you know, for anyone. Because even the leaders do not agree with that. Sometimes they say, oh, so-and-so is Muslim is Aman. Muslim bin Aqeel, being the ambassador of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And this is where we have to be careful. And I'll say to them that when it comes to Ashab Hussein, even the Ansar of Mahdi, the companions of Mahdi, they also, even now, or when they will come, they will be reciting this statement from Ziyad al-Waris, فَيَا لَيْتَنِي كُنْتُ مَعَكُمْ فَعَفُوذُ فَوْضًا عَظِيمًا. Even the Ansar of Mahdi look at the Ashab of Hussein, and they wish that we could have been with you to attain that status. So do not bring ordinary people on a whatever higher level they are, we respect them, but they are not Hussein is Aman. They cannot be compared in that way at all. Salawat on Akbar. Āshurā ka din bhi sirf ek din nahi hai tareekh mein. Ye din bilkul alag hai. Aur ye haqeeqat jo hai Karbala se pehle ki hai. Pehli baar ye jo jumla Āshurā ke bare mein Imam Hussain ke din ke bare mein bayan kiya gaya hai. Imam Hasan alaihi salam ko jab zahar diya gaya, ek baar Hussain ibn Ali aaye, bhai the, dekhne aate the tabiyat kaisi hai. Ek baar jab aaye Imam Hasan ki halat ko dekhi to Hussain rone lage. Bade bhai kehte hain, ma yubki ka ya aba Abdullah, ae aba Abdullah, ae Hussain kyon ro rahe ho, kis baat pe ro rahe ho? Us waqt Hussain ne kaha, hum isliye ro rahe hain jo aapki halat hui hai. Is par Imam ne kaha ke dekho, mujhe zeher diya gaya hai, usi se hum khatam ho jayenge, lekin tum mat ro. Walakin la yawm ka yawm ka ya Aba Abdullah. Imam Hasan kehte hain कि मुझ पर उतना मत रो, इसलिए कि ऐ हुसैन तुम्हारा जो दिन होगा कोई और दिन उस लेवल पर नहीं है मसाइब के एतबार से. आशूर का दिन मखसूस है हुसैन के लिए. कम से कम आशूर का दिन सिर्फ अज़ाए हुसैन के लिए होना चाहिए. ये जो मसाइब हैं वहां के बहुत हैं. और ये जो बात आती है इस हदीस के बारे में बहुत गुफ्तगू है, लेकिन इंशाअल्लाह किसी और वक्त, कि क्यों इमाम हसन ने ये कहा है कि हुसैन आपका दिन एक अजीम दिन है मसाइब के एतबार से. अस्हाब की मुसीबत को आप देखें, अहले हरम की मुसीबत को आप देखें. आज के दिन इत्तेफाक से मुनासिबत के लिहाज से वो दिन है कि ये काफिला दमिश्क के दरवाजे के पास पहुंचा है. अज़ादारन हुसैन जो हुक्म दिया गया था कि शहर को सजाया जाए, तैयारी की जाए, ताकि पब्लिक के सामने ये ऐलान हो कि यजीद जो है अपनी जीत और फतह की खुशी मना रहा है. लोगों से कहा गया था कि घरों से बाहर निकल के आएं, और जो रूट है जिससे इन सरों को और अहले हरम को ले जाया जाएगा वहाँ पे आएं वो, ताकि तमाशाई बन सकें वो. زدارت حسین جب یہ قافلہ بالکل شہر کے اندر جانے لگا شمر ملعون نے حکم دیا اپنے سپاہیوں کو جن کے پاس نیزے تھے جن پر شہداء کے سر تھے وہ حکم دیتا ہے کہ تم جو ہے آہستہ آہستہ محملوں کے قریب جاؤ اہل حرم کی جو سواری ہیں انہی کے آس پاس رہو اس نے یہ کیوں حکم دیا تھا اس لیے کہ آپ جانتے ہیں اس زمانے میں بھی نیزے کے اوپر سروں کو دیکھنا کوئی کامن سین نہیں تھی اور وہ جانتا تھا نفسیات کے لحاظ سے یہ شمر ملعون کہ لوگوں کی نظر جو ہے نیزوں پر جائے گی لیکن وہ خبیث چاہ رہا تھا کہ لوگ صرف سروں کو نہ دیکھیں بلکہ حسین کے اہل حرم کو بھی دیکھیں زینب ام کلثوم اور اہل حرم کو اور اذیت دینے کے لیے اس ملعون نے یہ حکم دیا جناب ام کلثوم جب یہ دیکھتی ہیں کہ یہ جو ہے نیزوں کو قریب لا رہے ہیں لوگوں کی نظر اب حملوں کی طرف بھی جائے گی پریشان ہو جاتی ہیں جاتی ہیں شمر ملعون کے سامنے درخواست لے کے اگر یہ قیامت نہیں ہو کیا ہے فاطمہ کی بیٹی شمر ملعون کے سامنے درخواست لے کے جا رہی ہے کہ اپنے سپاہیوں سے کہو کہ نیزوں کو لے کے آگے بڑھے لیکن اس ملعون نے کوئی جواب نہیں دیا لیکن حسین کی 4 سال کی بچی جسے ہم سکینہ کہتے ہیں اس نے جناب ام کلثوم کے چہرے کو دیکھا زینب کی اذیت کو دیکھا ماں کی پریشانی کو بھی دیکھتی ہے تھوڑی دیر میں سہل بن سعد رسول اللہ کے ایک صحابی تھے وہ اسی دن بیت المقدس سے دمشق پہنچے تھے بھیڑ جب انہوں نے دیکھی تو پوچھتے ہیں کیا ہوا ہے کہا کہ خارجی ہے جس کا سر لایا جا رہا ہے اور اس کے گھر والوں کو بھی اسیر کیا گیا ہے جب نام پوچھتا ہے تو لوگ کہتے ہیں حسین ابن علی سہل بن سعد پریشان ہو گئے اور آگے بڑھتے ہیں قافلے کے قریب جب آئے ہیں اس 4 سال کی بچی کو دیکھتے ہیں قریب جاتے ہیں کہتے ہیں کہ ہم تمہارے جد کے صحابی ہیں اگر کچھ ہو سکتا ہے مجھ سے تو بتاؤ افسوس لے 4 سال کا وہ سن ہے لیکن پریشانی سکینہ کو اپنی نہیں ہے ماں بہن اور پھوپھی کی ہے فوراً کہتی ہے کہ اگر تم سے ہو سکے تو ان سپاہیوں سے کہو اپنے نیزوں کو لے کے آگے بڑھ جائے عزداران حسین عجب نہیں کہ اسی وقت جو ہے حسین کا سر جو ہے آیا سورہ کہف کی تلاوت شروع کر دیتا ہے عجب نہیں کہ حسین نے جب بیٹی کی اذیت کو دیکھا ہے آیات کی تلاوت شروع کرتے ہیں تاکہ لوگوں کی توجہ سر پر جائے اور زینب کلثوم زیادہ اس اذیت میں گرفتار نہ ہو اے سر بریدہ قاری قرآن السلام اے نوک سنا پہ مرکز ایمان السلام الا لعنت اللہ علی القوم الظالمین سیعلم الذین ظلموا ای منقلب ینقلبون خدا وند اس قلعے بعد قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہمارے توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خدا وند عالم اسلام بے صلاح الامن کی فضا پیدا کر تکفیری افواج کی تمام صلاحیتوں کو نیست و نابود فرما خدا وند امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم ماتم حسین